Oh, come, let's worship and bow down. Let's kneel before Yahweh our Maker, for He is our God. We are the people of His pasture and the sheep in His care.
Oh, So today, we will be looking at Daniel chapter 3, if you'd like to follow along. And as you can probably tell by being at the end of the year, and also, well, if you know the order of the books, you can tell that we're getting towards the end of the Old Testament. But now, after many prophecies and warnings to the kings and the people of Judah, they refused to turn from their ways and turn to God. So what's happened? Well, what we were saying was going to happen. The Babylonian exile, Babylon came in, captured Judah. And the king of Babylon decides to really take the best and the brightest young men, train them up as leaders, and not necessarily brainwash them, but to train them up as leaders to work in his government, to be his advisors, to be his personal servants, to oversee his vast empire. And among them, we see our Daniel, who's, of course, the most important one in the book of Daniel, but also his three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Now, King Nebuchadnezzar made an image of gold, whose height was 60 cubits and its breadth 6 cubits. He set it up on the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. So earlier, Daniel had interpreted King Nebuchadnezzar's dream, and before this happened, and what was in the dream was a giant statue. The giant statue had a head of gold, which represented Babylon, and then the chest and arms of silver represented Persia. The middle and the thighs of it represented Greece. They're made out of bronze. The legs of iron and the feet of iron and clay represented the Roman Empire. They really represented, in short, they were kingdoms that were still to come, empires that were still to come that they didn't know about yet. And they were going to be the next superpowers, which were going to replace Babylon. So one was going to replace the other, and so on. So Nebuchadnezzar was really making a statement here when he made this statue entirely out of gold. He was essentially saying that no kingdom was going to come after his. That his kingdom wasn't ever going to end. It was always going to be the world superpower. And this statue was 60 cubits, so it was 90 feet tall. And again, it was made out of gold, so that might have been, I would say that would be pretty impressive, 90-foot gold statue. Just imagine a 10-story building, only a statue. So that that would be something to see. And he set it up on this plank, so everything was flat around it, and all you could see was this giant statue. Then King Nebuchadnezzar sent to gather the satraps, the prefects, and the governors, the counselors, the treasurers, the justices, the magistrates, and all the officials of the provinces to come to the dedication of the image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Then the satraps, the prefects, the governors, the counselors, the treasurers, the justices, and the magistrates, and all the officials of the provinces gathered for the dedication of the image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. And they stood before the image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up. So all of the leaders, and we just had a big long list there, every kind of leader, every kind of government officer, from all corners of this vast empire, they were called to come to this dedication ceremony. So this was a big deal. And the herald proclaimed, "You are commanded, O peoples, O nations, and languages, that when you hear the sound of the horn, the pipe, the lyre, the trigon, the harp, the bagpipe, and every kind of music, you are to fall down and worship the golden image that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall be immediately cast into a burning, fiery furnace." Therefore, as soon as the peoples heard the sound of the horn, the pipe, the lyre, the trigon, the harp, the bagpipe, and every kind of music, all the peoples, nations, and languages fell down and worshiped the golden image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. So it's not surprising, if you don't fall down and worship this statue, you'll be thrown into the fiery furnace that pretty much everybody did as they were told. I wonder how that sounded, though, with the bagpipes thrown in. You know, that might have been interesting. Every kind of music plus bagpipes. Therefore, at the time, certain Chaldeans came forward and maliciously accused the Jews. They declared to King Nebuchadnezzar, "O king, live forever. You, O king, have made a decree that every man who hears the sound of the horn, the pipe, the lyre, the trigon, the harp, the bagpipe, and every kind of music shall fall down and worship the golden image. And whoever does not fall down to worship shall be cast into a burning fiery furnace. There are certain Jews among who you have appointed over the affairs of the provinces of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, pay no attention to you. They do not serve your gods or worship the golden image you've set up." It's interesting in this whole story, we'll see as it progresses, that Daniel really isn't part of the story. He's not mentioned. Yet, the same kind of stuff really happens to Daniel in this book. He gets accused. People conspire to find a way to bring him down. And they use his faith, they use his desire to follow God as the thing to sort of catch him with, or sort of accuse him with. But Daniel ends up choosing between God and what was easy to do. Daniel ends up choosing God, and he ends up getting a punishment. In the case, he was thrown into the lion's den, if you know the story. And in this case, we'll see what happens to these three. Something similar. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in furious rage, commanded Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to be brought. So he brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar answered and said to them, "Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the golden image I have set up? Now, if you are ready, when you hear the sound of the pipe, the horn, the lyre, the trigon, the harp, the bagpipe, and every kind of music, to fall down and worship the image I've set up, well and good. But if you do not worship, you shall immediately be cast into a burning fiery furnace. And who is the God who will deliver you out of my hands?" So the king is angry. Obviously, he's very angry, but at the same time, these three are very capable. They're Daniel's friends. And the king would rather not lose three very capable advisors. So he kind of gives them a way out. He gives them a way to avoid being thrown into the fiery furnace. And I kind of understand King Nebuchadnezzar here. As you might, some of you know, I teach, sub-teach middle school. And the same thing kind of happens. I find myself in the same situation. I give a student one more chance. Maybe they didn't hear me. Maybe there was some kind of misunderstanding. I give them one more chance, kind of put them on the spot a little bit. But if they deliberately disobey me then, they get a trip to the fiery furnace, which is actually the principal's office. If some of you know John Savage, you know that's kind of is how it is. But anyway, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If this be so, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. But if not, be it known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up." So they didn't doubt. This is always kind of a curious passage in the story. They didn't doubt God's ability to deliver them from the fiery furnace. Yet they acknowledged that they really didn't know what was going to happen. God works in mysterious ways and unpredictable ways. We see that throughout the Old Testament. Sometimes God delivers people in a very dramatic way, parting the Red Sea, for example. But other times, especially with the prophets and even some of the good kings, bad stuff still happens. And that's kind of true in our life, too. And what really matters is what God is doing in the long term, what God is doing with our lives in the long term, what God's grand purpose is. But that's kind of another message for another time. But they were prepared for whatever outcome. What mattered to them was following God, not necessarily what the outcome was going to be. Of course, they probably hoped that they were going to be saved, I would think. The Nebuchadnezzar was filled with fury, and the expression of his face was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He ordered the furnace heated 7 times more than it was usually heated. So was it really heated 7 times what it was? Well, as we see in the Bible, the number 7 usually means perfection. And in this case, it could mean actually 7 times as hot, or it could mean just as hot as it could possibly get. Really hot. And it's kind of like, it reminds me of, and if you all have seen it, turn the speakers to 11. I guess you all know that. Maybe you don't know that movie, but they usually go to 10, but somebody had a speaker they could turn to 11. So this is kind of what it was like. They were hot enough anyway. The furnace is hot enough, but he's saying, we're going to make it extra hot. And he ordered some of the mighty men of his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and to cast them into the burning fiery furnace. And these men were bound in their cloaks, their tunics, their hats, and their other garments, and they were thrown into the burning fiery furnace. Because the king's order was urgent and the furnace overheated, the flame killed those men who took them up. And these 3 men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell bound into the fiery furnace. Then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished and rose up in haste. He declared to his counselors, "Did we not cast 3 men bound into the fire?" And they answered and said to the king, "True, O king." And he answered and said, "But I see 4 men bound, unbound, walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt. And the appearance of the 4th is like a son of the gods." Then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the door of the burning fiery furnace, and he declared, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out and come here." The 4th man is described as being like a son of the gods. And many believe that this passage, like many others in the Old Testament, is a Christophany. An appearance of Jesus before the Incarnation. Of course, in this Christmas season, we celebrate the Incarnation of Jesus, being born in the manger. But there are many mentions of the Son of Man in the Old Testament, and in a lot of ways, it seems very likely that it's talking about Jesus. The appearance of Jesus, and of course, Jesus being God, has always existed. And there, again, the God of the Old Testament, this also shows us, too, that since Jesus appears in the Old Testament, the God of the Old Testament is really the same as the God of the New Testament. And we might tend to forget that sometimes, because the Old Testament, as we've seen this whole year, the Old Testament is pretty violent sometimes. It has some moments that can kind of make you cringe. But through all of that, we still see God's mercy. We still see Jesus in every story of the Old Testament, in every book. And really, to know the Old Testament is to also know Jesus. And Jesus himself even said that. He's the fullness of the Scriptures, the fullness of the Old Testament. Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out of the fire. And the satraps, the prefects, and the governors, and the king's counselors gathered together and saw that the fire had not had any power over the bodies of those men. The hair of their heads was not singed. Their clothes were not harmed. And there was no smell of fire on them. So God completely protects Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They don't even smell like they've been in a fire, which is kind of miraculous, I think. At the same time, Nebuchadnezzar's servants accidentally perish, just carrying them to the fire to be thrown in. So it's interesting that this also echoes a major theme in the Old Testament. You have God's unlimited power versus the very limited power and the false hope in idols and human deliverance, human power. So Nebuchadnezzar isn't able to even save his servants. So who is the real God? Who is the real Savior? Who is our real hope? The stories of the Old Testament show us this time and time again, that our real hope is in God and not in human strength and human work. So Nebuchadnezzar answered and said, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him and set aside the king's commandments, yielding up their bodies rather than serve and worship any god except their own God. Therefore I make a decree. Any people, nation, or language that speaks anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be torn limb from limb, and their houses laid in ruins. For there is no other God who is able to rescue them any other way." Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were promoted in the province of Babylon. So in the end, God is glorified. And these three men are actually promoted. The same ones who were thrown into the fiery furnace, the same ones who their jealous fellow officers conspired against. They were promoted, and the king admires their integrity and makes a special decree. So the circumstances are really reversed, aren't they? Miraculously. So maybe we won't be asked to listen to bagpipe music and bow down to a 9-foot golden statue. But we might find ourselves in similar situations every day. So what does this really look like for us? What does this look like for us, the situation that we find ourselves in every day? What is the statue? What is the fire? And who is this fourth person that's in the fire with us? So first off, what is the statue for us? Well, it's really something that aggressively demands our worship and our attention. Something other than God, of course. Something like a false idol. And again, we experience this every day. No matter what we do, no matter where we live, we experience this. And one example, of course, is Sunday morning. There are lots of things that demand our attention on Sunday morning. Lots of diversions, lots of things that we have had to say no to just to be here for a couple of hours. So many diversions. And of course, 50 years ago, there were still diversions. 100 years ago, there were still diversions, but it seemed that there weren't so many. And life in 2018 is really hard, isn't it, with everything that we have. All of the Netflix and the different things that we can do, the different things that we can watch. It's kind of a hard life in a way. In a way, because there are so many things that draw our attention and even take our attention away from time with family, time with the people who really matter in our lives. And of course, like the golden statue, but you know, these things can be good in and of their own, but the problem happens when they draw us away from the things that are more important. And then there's also social pressure. All of us face social pressure from one degree to another. So nobody's really safe from it. And I see this a lot with middle schoolers. Of course, they face the students. Really, everybody faces social pressure. It doesn't end when we leave school, of course. There's always social pressure to follow the crowd, as we see in this story. We see it especially in this story, to bow down to this idol, to be like everybody else. There's always that pressure. And also, we see this throughout the Old Testament, because the people of Israel, the main reason why they followed the idols, the main reason why they had difficulty following God, really had to do with their desire to be just like everybody else around them. So the Bible, and especially the Old Testament, has a strong message to us that we don't have to conform. We don't have to be just like everybody around us. And the rewards are great for those who don't give in to the pressure. So the statue in our lives really wants us to settle, really wants us to take the path well-traveled, which is usually the easy path, the way of least resistance. And often, too, we're criticized if we don't take this easy path, which also makes it even harder, doesn't it? Not only are we taking the harder path, but we also kind of have the social pressure, too, take the easy path. And sometimes this social pressure, sometimes this temptation, sometimes these feelings of missing out, sometimes those really feel like the fire itself, the fiery furnace, don't they? So what is this fire really? What is this fire in our lives? It's really a consequence for not giving in, the temporary adversity or the trials that we encounter along the way, for following the path that God wants us to take, which isn't always the easiest way. And we know, and we've known many people who have done this over and over again in their lives. All of them are fondly remembered as very extraordinary people. And we've really been reminded of that recently, haven't we? So God really calls all of us to be extraordinary. No matter who we are, no matter what our situation is, we're all called to be extraordinary. All of us are called by God to really use our spiritual gifts, to really step outside our comfort zones each day. And God also uses the fire to help us, in a way, or allows for that experience sometimes. For young people, and also for all of us, not that we are young, so, I mean, it's all about how old you feel, right? And It gives us experience, and we gain a testimony from that. And it also helps us to keep feeling young, to keep having these experiences and these challenges. They're hard, yes, in a way, but they also make us feel younger. They also give us more energy in the end. So this is really the narrow path, really the path that leads to abundant living. It's the path of wisdom we see in the whole Bible. Yet in the fire, God is really with us. So that brings us to our final question. Who was this fourth person that we see in the fire? And of course, the one who is in the fire with us today. This season, we celebrate God becoming God with us in the birth of Jesus. Yet, as we've seen throughout our journey through the Old Testament this year, God has really always been God with us throughout all time. And in the fire, we often see this most clearly. God is there, and God has always been there with us.
Here is a story from the good book we know, a story about a miracle that happened long ago. We hope that you'll take courage when temptations you meet. There's somebody watching you, strong when you're weak.
They wouldn't bend.
They held on to the will of God, so we are told.
They wouldn't bow.
They wouldn't bow their knees to the idols made of gold.
They wouldn't burn.
They were protected by the fourth man in the fire.
They wouldn't bend.
They wouldn't bow. They wouldn't burn. The prophet Daniel tells about three men who walked with God. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, for the wicked king they stood. And the king commanded them, bound and thrown, the fire burns that day.
And the fire so hot that the men were slain, that forced them on their way.
They held on to the will of God, so we are told. They wouldn't bow their knees to the idol made of gold.
They wouldn't burn.
They were protected by the fourth man in the fire. They wouldn't bend. They wouldn't bow. They wouldn't burn.
When the three were cast in and the king rose up to witness their awful fate, he began to tremble at what he saw in astonished tone he spake.
Did we not cast three men all down into the midst of the fire?
And lo, I see four men unhurt, unbound, walking all around down there.
The Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and lo, I see four men
of God.
They held on to the will of God, so we are told. They wouldn't bow their knees to the idol made of gold.
They wouldn't bow.
They were protected by the fourth man in the fire.
They wouldn't bend.
They wouldn't bow. They wouldn't burn.
They wouldn't bend.
They held on to the will of God, so we are told.
They wouldn't bow.
They wouldn't bow their knees to the idol made of gold.
They wouldn't burn.
They were protected by the fourth man in the fire.
They wouldn't bend.
They wouldn't bow. They wouldn't burn.
They wouldn't bend.
Yahweh bless you and keep you. Yahweh make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. Yahweh lift up his face toward you and give you peace.
Jesus.